Hello friends, in the sequence of ENT lecture of orthology, we are going to discuss the last topic of this session, and we have already accomplished various orthological important topics of the curriculum, including from the very beginning from the anatomy section to the inflammatory segment of the canal, disease of the external ear, disease of the middle ear, including cholesteatoma, secretory otitis media, acute otitis media, chronic suppurative otitis media, complication of the CS1, and subsequently we have already discussed in two lectures a very important topic, tinnitus or tinnitus. Now, in the concluding class of this session of otology, we are having a very important topic today, which is otalgia or pain in the ear. Then after this segment, we will start with the literary part of the Indian system of the medicine or Ayurvedic segment. We will take some important references from Sushruta Samhita and also the other valid references in which are scattered in various other prominent Ayurvedic scriptures or literature. And then we will discuss the Ayurvedic segment as well. Today's topic for the class will be otalgia. So otalgia is I will go for a large picture. Okay, this otalgia is a very common presentation even in ENT OPD, as a majority of the patients comes or visits ENT OPD, rather ear OPD, with problems like discharge, hearing of abnormal sounds, and pain and hearing loss. So today's topic will be what about the pain if the end patient visits the OPD with the pain complaint that is called as otalgia. Otalgia, obviously, otal is the word, and otalgia stands for pain in the ear. So we have got a primarily, we have divided the otalgia topic in two segments. Number one, the structures which are directly involved in the pain in the ear, or the ear itself is the cause of the pain in the ear, that is called as a primary otalgia, or when the pain is as a result of structures which are of the ear itself. And the second classification or the referred is when the pain is originated is, or the genesis of the pain is around the ear structures, or the structures which surrounds the ear. When the pain is originated from the structures which surrounds the ear, then it is called as referred otalgia. So primary otalgia is the otalgia which is which caters with the pain which is originating from the ear itself, whereas the secondary or the referred otalgia is when the pain originates outside the ear from the surrounding structures of the ear. So we have already in the anatomical part, we have discussed that various nerves which are supplies the pinna, the canal, the tympanic membrane, and the middle ear apparatus. So we need not to repeat this in this topic. So by and large, as far as the anatomy is concerned, for the intervention, neural intervention of the pinna, we have got a trigeminal nerve intervention, we have got a vagus nerve, and we have got a greater auricular nerve, which is C1-C2. So we have got a vagus nerve involvement, trigeminal nerve, and C1-C2, which are responsible for the pain in the even in the pinna, canal, and the middle ear. So we will not go into detail. These are some important causative agents or causative factors or etiological factors which are responsible for a painful ear or the pain complaint for the patient which visits the otological OPD or the ENT OPD. So the pinna causes may be some are common are trauma. Trauma may be laceration, we have already discussed. Hematoma is a collection of the blood between the skin and a perichondrium that is called as hematoma. Obviously, the trauma, the frictional injury in which there is a separation of the subcutaneous tissue and the skin from the underlying perichondrium or even the chondrium also or the cartilage itself. Next is a perichondrium, which is called as a red hot tender pinna. Red hot tender pinna is the perichondrium, which is a bacterial infection, and you have to give some antibiotics and analgesic as well as hot fomentation in case of a perichondritis. By and large, the clinical appreciation in the case of a perichondritis or acute perichondritis will be a red hot tender pinna. Then infected preauricular sinus. Preauricular sinus is a congenital pathology in which we have got a dipping pit and a tract which goes deep even down to the parotid fascia. So this is a congenital pathology of a tract which is epithelialized tract, which has got various groups also, like a pseudopod, and it's a congenital pathology of a sinus formation. Next is a temperature related injury. A higher temperature can lead to a sunburn, and a lower temperature or a sub-zero temperature can lead to a frostbite. Then a tumor related pain. When the tumor is having a ulcerative or a or destroying pathology, then and the involvement of the nerves can cause a pain also. In case of a auditory canal or external auditory canal, there are various factors which can cause pain from a mild to a very severe pain, like in a case of an impacted back, so rarely causes pain, but if the patient has manipulated or the physician has manipulated the back, or he has imparted some kind of a trauma to the canal in the process of removing this back, then the patient can have some bleeding also from the canal wall also. So these cases then get secondary infection, secondary bacterial infection can have a picture of a acute otitis externa. Then itself is a very painful kind of a picture the patient can present. So this vest itself is not a painful pathology, but removal of the vest in the process of doing some kind of an intervention, that leads to some trauma to the canal or the tympanic membrane, and the patient can have a secondary bacterial infection, and this can have a swollen or a painful canal in this clinical picture. Next is a foreign body. Again, foreign body itself causes a mild pain depending upon the size and the nature of the foreign body. But in the process of removing this foreign body, invariably the doctor or the relative of the patient or the patient himself can give a variety of injuries to the canal, which itself can cause a pain. Keratosis obturans is a epithelialization of a canal. In the patient has got a huge epithelial chunks of plate, and itself can cause a pain itself. Next is a very important cause of the pain of the canal. This is otitis externa, which is inflammatory event or inflammatory sequence of the external ear. External ear, as in the previous segment we have already discussed, is canal plus pinna both. Next is a malignant otitis externa. This is a grave picture, supposed to be a disease which is reserved for immunocompetent but immunocompromised patients and poorly controlled the diabetic patients, and there is a huge inflammatory sequence growth, and there is a loss of tissue, bleeding in the canal. This is malignant otitis externa, and next is a viral pathology. And the next is a viral pathology in which we have got numerous vesicular eruptions of the canal on the pinna itself, along with the facial palsy or without the facial palsy. Along with the facial palsy, the herpes zoster is called a Ramsay-Hunt syndrome. Again, I will write it. It will be called as a Ramsay-Hunt syndrome. What is Ramsay-Hunt? Viral otitis externa plus a facial nerve palsy. plus a facial nerve palsy is called as Ramsey-Hunt syndrome. And Ramsey-Hunt syndrome. Next is the exostosis. Exostosis is a bony swelling, bowling, a hard swelling of the canal, which can lead to obstruction of the canal itself, and the patient can subsequently have a hearing loss. Next is a tumor pathology. And depending upon the ulceration available in the tumor, the patient can range from a pain from a mild pain to a moderate pain to a very severe pain, even in extensive cases. Next is other causes of otalgia, which are related to the tympanic membrane, the middle ear, and the mesoid segment. So these are some middle ear causes which can cause a painful ear or otalgia. This is bullous laryngitis, acute otitis media, by far the most common cause of pain in the ear as far as middle ear is concerned. Acute otitis media is an acute inflammatory reaction of the middle ear and inflammatory extension of the secretory otitis media. In case of a secretory otitis media, the fluid which is collected in the middle ear is sterile. In case of a acute otitis media, it is filled with, the middle ear is filled with inflammatory products, and there are the features of acute inflammation are present in the middle ear, including Ruber, Dollar scalar, and punctured lacia. In case of a traumatic perforation, also the patient can have a pain. Hemotympanum is collection of blood in the middle ear. And by far, the most common cause is road traffic accident and temporal bone fractures. A barotrauma is a eustachian tube dysfunction in which there is a extensive negative pressure in the middle ear, which leads to connection in the middle ear, like in a case of secretory otitis media. Also, in case of a mesoid segment, these are some common examples which can cause otalgia. Mastoiditis is an extension of acute otitis media in which there is an involvement of the mastoid air. Mastoid itself is a large air-filled cavity which is posterior to the middle ear. So, acoustic trauma is a noise-induced hearing loss. Noise in ears rarely causes pain, whereas schwannoma itself rarely causes pain. These are some endoscopic pictures of the cases we have already discussed in case of etiological factors of otalgia. These are some schematic diagram as well as endoscopic pictures. This is a case of a impacted back. You can see in this case the whole of the canal is blocked by a piece of a back, and you know, when the physician or the patient himself try to manipulate it, it can give a frictional injury to the canal itself, and the canal can bleed also. And when it gets the secondary bacterial infection, that can present itself as a fairly painful picture to the patient. Next is foreign bodies already discussed. These are some foreign bodies. It's supposed to be a vegetable, a seed of some kind. These are some living or non-living, both foreign bodies. This seems to be an ant or an insect foreign body. So itself is not painful, but at the time of removal, it can cause some kind of an injury to the canal, which is quite painful. Next is acute otitis externa. We have got two type of acute otitis externa. Acute otitis externa has got two pictures. When a part of the canal is involved, that is called as localized otitis externa, and whole of the canal or various quadrant involvement is there, then it is called as diffuse otitis externa. Localized otitis externa is by far the most commonly presented by a staphylococcus infection of the hair follicle, or also called as pyogenic folliculitis is a staphylococcus aureus bacterial infection of the root of the hair follicle, which is called as pyogenic folliculitis. And this is quite a painful picture, and the trigger sign is positive. So it's a very invaluable sign in case of a diagnosis of acute otitis externa or a staphylococcus infection. This is called as a trigger sign. What is a trigger sign? If you tend to move the tragus inwards, or medially the patient has got an excruciating episode of a pain, or manipulation of the pressure causes pain to the patient. This is called as a pressure sign, and because cartilage of the canal is nothing but the extension of the pinna cartilage itself. So any kind of a manipulation of the pinna or of the tragus leads to movement of this extension of this extended canal cartilage as well, and hence causes pain. Apart from that, the skin of the canal is tightly adherent to the underlying pericondrium and cartilage, and there are no space available for extension for the exudative or transudative product of inflammation. So this is invariably a very painful pathology, and pressure sign is positive. We have already discussed in pathology of the canal and pinna, and treatment by and large is packing the canal, giving antibiotics and analgesics, and packing of the canal is also very important if you want to apply some kind of a medicine to the canal. So this is a clinical picture. You can see that this is a staphylococcus infection, and this is a hair follicle infection. So because hair follicles are present in outer one third of the canal itself, the medial two-third is called as a bony canal, and this is devoid of any kind of a phyllosebaceous glands or hair follicle as well. So these acute otitis externa localized are limited to outer one third of the canal itself, because the hair follicles are present in outer one third of the canal itself. So next is acute otitis externa disease. This is a disease form which is usually seen by unskilled instrumentation, and the patient scratches his ear. Then it leads to a circumferential canal involvement, and whole of the quadrants of the canal are involved. In case of a localized, one of the canal segment is involved, and if the whole of the circumferential involvement of the canal, edema is there, then it is called a diseased form of acute otitis externa, and also commonly seen in infamous also. And the causative agents are Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Staphylococcus aureus. And you need to, you cannot, to give a good oral toilet, you have to clean the canal and give a medicated packing to the patient, and also give him steroid to reduce the edema, apart from giving him analgesic and a broad spectrum antibiotic. So this is a clinical picture. This is a picture of a localized. You can see a single quadrant, superior quadrant is involved. There is a case of a diseased otitis. There is a despermatization of the whole segment of the efflorentary canal. That the parenchymal membrane seems to be normal, but there are secretions, waxy secretions are present, and there is a congestion look also, and the secretion also leads to, this is called as impetigo contagiosa, or the infective secretion cause a circumferential involvement of the area adjoining to the opening of the canal also, or the skin also, and this can cause a circumferential fibrosis also. And then it will be called as a chronic stenotic otitis externa. Chronic stenotic otitis externa. There will be a circumferential stenosis of the external auditory canal. And in extensive or in advanced cases, the whole of the external auditory canal may compromise, or may be blocked in case of a long-standing case. Malignant otitis externa is when there is extensive involvement of the structures which are surrounding the acknowledgement canal, the pinna, and the midlayer, and the organism involved is the Pseudomonas, which is a very sensitive organism and rarely respond to the antibiotics as well. The concept of super antigen has also challenged the usage of frequently used antibiotics. So the patient has to be managed aggressively and has to be admitted. The debridement should be done. The non-vital or necrosed tissue should be sacrificed until you see fresh bleeding and granulation. And this is a typical presentation present in a poorly controlled diabetic patient, and even immunocompromised patient. These are some cases of a malignant otitis externa. There will be involvement of the Now, cranial nerves as well, where there will be involvement of seventh. In this case, the patient is having a facial palsy as well. So, the involvement of a facial palsy in case of otitis externa is suggestive of a malignant in nature. Malignant in the sense is not neoplastic, but the aggressiveness of the pathology, the virulence of the pathology of the organism is such that there is involvement of surrounding structures in, along with the cranial nerves 8th and 7th as well, and the patient can undergo a facial palsy, a non-recoverable complete facial palsy as well. So the patient has to be a strict diabetic control should be done, offered to the patient. The debridement of the devitalized or the necrosed tissue should be done in operation theater, and a broad spectrum IV antibiotics should be offered to the patient for extended period of time for 6 to 8 weeks. So we will conclude this topic in the next class. This is supposed to be the otalgia lecture 1. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe to the channel.